What's up, man? How you guys doing?
Chilling. Hi, Moses.
And we have Moses with us.
Okay. Yeah. Well, what do you mean? This is technically, we are here. Technically, you are hosting us.
No, I'm like, technically, well, that's true.
Yes. So, yes. Welcome us to your place.
Welcome you guys. Great to have you.
This boy is badly behaved. We should be welcoming him to the show. Hi, Moses. Welcome to Meet and
Please, Meet. Let's quickly plug the cube.
Yes, and then yes, shooting at the IMAX cinema in film Lekki. House Lekki Phase One Cube,
the number one cinema in West Africa.
Thank you very much.
So we have done our sponsorship for 3 years.
Please place your advert here.
So I mean, it's not really funny now. So basically, you welcome somebody into your house, it is in their house.
Yes.
So,
no, now.
Yes, now.
If I'm like, going to enter my room, although I'm a guest in your house, at least you still knock. Now. You still
tell me that. Exactly, because Moses is well behaved. Yes. So in fact, we are welcoming you.
Ladies and gentlemen, England.
That's so.
Yeah.
So Moses, let me ask one question.
Yeah.
How did this COVID thing affect cinema?
Wow.
Don't start crying, though.
It's actually quite emotional.
It's happened.
I mean, you know why? Because that question has been reoccurring.
Yeah, okay.
And it's not going away, you know. Particularly, you know, we don't know when this will be over, you know.
Mm.
And so we've had to be answering it. If I count now, every month, either in media interviews, either, you know, those that are, you know, showing compassion, or family members looking at how you're doing, or industry enthusiasts, industry practitioners, asking how it's been going. It's been really, really challenging. It's been tough. But you know, in it all, like, the silver lining is that it's also created the opportunity for Nigerian films to step up.
Ding, 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 Omogeto.
You should say Kwam's money first.
Right.
Omogeto.
Omogeto, definitely standout performer. But look, the succession of films and quality films at that, for the cinemas has kept the cinemas alive. Awesome. You just need to look at the last few weeks, you know, in February, and the Valentine themed or love themed films, and how
you can say romantic comedies.
Romantic comedies,
you know,
yeah,
you know that word. Every romantic comedies, you chase the men away.
Yeah, so well, it's love theme. I just
can be a love theme action movie. Yeah, can be a love theme horror. You know,
just change it a little bit. But you know, those things have really helped. COVID, like, no one saw this thing coming. No one thought the impact would be, you know, far-reaching. And I think Nigerian cinemas and the Nigerian film industry deserves a lot of credit for us to still be at it, you know, for creativity to have blossomed. A number of films were made during the pandemic. A number of cinemas were opened during the pandemic.
Yeah.
Even local platforms were launched
during
the pandemic. So, you know, whilst it's been really challenging, again, for me, it's testament to the Nigerian spirit, you know, of resilience.
Yeah. Yeah.
That despite it,
we die here.
Yeah, I'm telling you, we die here. You know, yeah. So yeah, I mean, I thank God. And look, we're having this conversation about it, you know, during these times, and hopefully we'll look back, you know. So yeah, I guess the answer is it's been challenging, but we're forward looking.
Oh, yeah, cool.
So Moses, there's something that I have to tell you. Damola thinks he came up with wedding party. Idea.
Okay.
No, wait. I came up with a wedding party idea.
I like the, let's use the article.
Okay. I came up with a wedding party idea. I spoke about it with Nas.
Okay.
A week before.
Oh, really?
A week before. No, a week before. The conversation between you and him to talk to Mo about the wedding party.
Yes.
We're at a wedding, and I was like, Nas, think about it. You can do a movie about the wedding. And I was like, look, it will be low budget because think about it. We're not spending money on costume. We'll just do one haul. Everybody dress up, do the same thing. Everybody comes back every day and we just shoot in the same
space. It's okay. We've heard you.
Yeah, but it was so cute how we thought it was a low budget movie.
And that was the difference between me and Mo. See, that's why I mean, a wedding party as against the wedding party.
Damola, that's amazing. Like, honestly. And I think that's why we need to document some of these things. A lot of these things going forward. Mm-hmm. Of course, I have a relationship with you guys, so I have no reason to doubt. But you know what? Just having that on tape would have been nice
wedding. No, but it didn't matter now because the wedding party that we made was the one that most brought to us. Remember, we had the conversation. I said, yes, we've been thinking about it, but we couldn't afford it.
And, yes.
So that was the conversation.
That was it.
Okay, yes. Okay. But the interesting thing is like, remember when we were talking about that, our Ocean's 11 type idea, and I said, oh, by the way, AY is doing Merryman.
No, that's true.
So we just put inside our cupboard.
Everybody, I mean, I think the ideas are like, look, you know how you drop one idea and then different people tap into it?
Yes.
It's always the first to implement and the best to implement.
Yes.
Yes, you know? So that's
very, very good.
But wait, now that we're talking about relationship, Moses, I have one question to ask you.
Okay.
Is there a film cabal?
Da da dum.
And so two,
what do you say to the people that say there is?
Wait. If there is a film cabal, are you a part of it?
Wow, that's an interesting question.
And three, how can we come?
How can we join this cabal? Which days are their meetings? If they exist.
So I'm going to try and be honest. I like the kind of conversation and this, you know, the style of it, and the directness of the question. Identify with a cabal, but I will say there is a group of progressive
thinkers.
Doers, risk takers,
implementers,
executors that have shown a level of consistency bar none. Okay. There's a group that exists and it's almost easy to identify. And if anybody has a problem with that, that's their wahala.
No, they don't have a problem. I think we should just let them know that if you want to that cabal.
Yeah, Zulu, why I think they have a problem is why is it being tagged as a cabal? Why can't it be progressives? Why can't it be, you know...
If someone calls you a snob, it's not because you're a snob.
Okay.
It's because they want you to talk to them.
Hey! Let me let that sink.
Yeah.
Zulu has decided that we're now doing Oprah. I think she watched the interview recently. So she's like, how can I be Oprah?
You know? Let me let that sink. No, but maybe there's a point there. That talk has happened so many times. And I'm like, look, if a group of people just get this thing right, understand it, and they've also had their losses and pain points, you know, but they're still keeping at it. You know,
exactly.
Let's celebrate what has made them, you know, what has made them this efficient at what they do or this successful. And let's also try and see whether there's a cabal is, are they willing to share knowledge? Are they willing to share information?
Exactly.
Do you understand? So for me, if they're willing and they're putting themselves out there every time, what is cabalistic about? A cabal would ensure that there's no way for you to come in. A cabal will ensure that they are hoarding information. A proper cabal will be like, this is for me and for me only.
Speaking of, I love what you guys sent out to your cabal members.
So that's you already.
Your yearbook.
Your
yearbook, yes. 2020 yearbook.
So it's so funny. Now the yearbook, like, so the first one, so it's like Moses them have discovered Photoshop. So the first, because the first version of that yearbook.
2018, I think.
Yeah, it was like, wow. So it was polished, but you can see
was
that.
Was it even Excel? Just use PowerPoint.
Yes, it was PowerPoint. PowerPoint PDF, yes.
Yeah, this one was really good, but besides all the packaging, like the content.
I love the content, and I love the numbers.
So what are you saying? So the other years have just been packaged.
I'm saying he is commending you on the packaging Photoshop. I'm saying besides all of that, like we've always enjoyed you guys packaging. You guys putting together all the information, documenting.
You guys recorded that. That's what Zulu meant, our packaging.
Which is also important because two things, right? So it's like when we were having a conversation about the box office top 25,
yes,
and you were like, write it down and put it in the thing. And then I saw my picture there and all of those things.
Oh, yes, you were in it.
Yes. And, yes. And because the thing is, and you were like, Naz, make sure that you put it in language that people can understand, which I took as an affront.
Please, Moses, here, please.
Collect your akalaka.
Yeah, thank you very much.
Because even we, sometimes you write some things to us. I said, and I have to call Zulu and say, Zulu, what did he say?
Oh, God, Naz, just bring it down to
just our level.
We know that there's this intelligentsia and academic level. Just bring it down. And shout out to Naz on a lot of number of points in terms of, like, you know, industry knowledge, you know, putting things numbers out there, numbers, putting a perspective, trends. You know, I always reach out to him, like, what do you think about putting this out? What do you you know, and his insight and advice are very, very useful.
So follow Naz on @IamSnaz.
Yes, so funny. Anytime I say something is interesting, I am now triggered because it was like, Naz,
it's not interesting.
It's not interesting. it's interesting to you.
To those who are interested.
To you.
It's also interesting it's to those who are interested.
But I like the Kabal talk. Notes. This Kabal talk is very, you know, we shouldn't gloss over it.
Okay, so
we should go back to
this Kabal. Yeah, should we go into the details?
Let's go.
So who are the members of this Kabal? So I won't do that. But one of the things that struck me, when I did the top 25 analysis was how many first and second time filmmakers were on the list. So technically, if it is a Kabal, you shouldn't have that many.
You shouldn't have enough.
Because enough of, there were so many first films in that top 25 list, that this is your first film or your second film that made it in there.
Ah, thank God for data. You can see data is even clear and vindicates us if there was any, you know.
Because it shows you that if you have the ambition, right, it's open to, because in our first podcast, we were talking about how poverty, the top 10 was back then, how the department entered with 7 million or 8 million there,
and entered top 10 for the year.
Yeah, it shows you how far we've come.
Yes.
You know, and shows you, I mean, if you look at it in 2015, that was, you know, and look at where we are 2021, but as an industry, and even at Inblot, you know, and Film One and all that, you know, I think we're making a lot of progress. But this Kabal thing, it will not go away. It wouldn't go away. And you know, I've come to accept that.
Yeah, so how have you come to terms with that? Because this used to be a big problem for you.
It used to be very tough for me to take. It used to really
especially
be hard.
Because, you know, I know that Film One, I know that we as well, and I know that a lot of people that we collaborate with and we are in a community with, we're sharers of information.
Yes.
And I don't know that there's anything that we've hidden from anyone who has asked.
Yes.
I don't think there's been any great idea that we haven't been like, let's jump on it and do it together. Which I don't think are elements of Kabbalism.
Let me just put this forward. Like, in terms of Inblot, the most collaborative, and this is not flattery or...
Well, you're on a podcast, so you have to flatter us.
But in terms of, you know, collaboration, willingness to take risks with others, in terms of partnership, which is a form of collaboration, in terms of sharing information, in terms of supporting other, you know, creators. I mean, I don't think anyone does it as great as you guys. And I mean that. It's awesome. In terms of just like, let's do it. Let's have the industry in mind. In terms of giving people their new breaks. I think that's very, very... And look, if people are going to term doing all of those as Kabbalistic, essentially you've been... initiated into the Kabbalah.
So you have now, so you came here to induct us.
We were trying to just basically let people know if there's a Kabbalah or not. Not to also now say that they are part of the Kabbalah.
Okay, separate
the two.
Okay. So I will not use the word Kabbalah. I think I've defined, you know, the group of, you know, dynamic, progressive people that we identify with and want to continue to put this country and the film industry on the global map. And I think that we're succeeding in doing that. If we're doing that, we're like we said, we've seen the growth between 2015 and 2021. We're providing jobs, you know, we're paying our taxes, we're creating opportunities, you know. I mean, I by all means, I want to belong to that group. I will not use Kabbalah, but I belong to that group. and Film One and all that, we belong to that group.
And so the interesting thing when you think about it long term is that when you look at our industry and how the industry has evolved and continued to evolve, I remember when we first started, cinema was not a part of the general equation in terms of films. And so the question was, if you wanted to be ambitious as a filmmaker, what could you do? So cinema has changed a bit from that perspective, but only on the commercial side, right? Yeah. So we have created a pathway for ambitious commercial filmmakers in the Nigerian ecosystem.
And that is Film One. A lot of kudos to Film One for that.
Yeah. Thank you
very much. And the cinemas, I suppose, who supported us. Because they didn't have to play Nollywood.
Well,
it's true, they didn't.
I mean,
they didn't, but you know, thank you. I mean, I don't know why I should be saying thank you, because this is your product, right? This is your country's.
I mean, it's weird.
No, but look at South Africa, 5% domestic.
Yeah, we should look at those. Let's look at the people that are doing it well, that are patriotic, right?
But
commend the people that are patriotic.
But that's valid, but I don't think it was patriotism.
It wasn't.
What is it?
It was commercial. It was money.
So at the beginning, when we were 5% of the market, you can argue that it was patriotism. But if.
That's what I'm talking about, actually.
When at the early stages of them choosing to play.
Yeah. Oh, okay.
Guys, this is when very intelligent people are talking. I'm listening.
And then over time, it became commercial because mm-hmm. with the rise of, like, I think, Isoken at the time, mm-hmm. Figurine, then, what was, AY Film, 30 Days in Atlanta.
Yeah.
So, like, basically the commerciality mm-hmm. of it. And now the cinemas are looking for commercial films.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. And so you can see that all the people we've talked about, the ambitious commercial filmmakers.
Yes.
But we should also not forget that there's the artistic and art house part of the industry mm-hmm. that we haven't yet quite figured out how, what is their path.
Yeah. They have a kebab.
Well,
you see that, I love to engage. I now, in the last 2 years, I have to say my eyes are a lot more open. I first of all, let me also class myself as a film lover.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And someone mm-hmm. that appreciates the art of filmmaking. And therefore, as much as I, of course, understand some of the limitations we have, finite capital, whether our audiences are there, you know, the cost of marketing, all that kind of stuff, why we always lean on the commercial films, mm-hmm. you know. I love those that are very alternative or alternate in thinking, you mm-hmm. know, and those that really, really are deliberate about the kind of stories they want to tell and kind of audiences they're going for. In the last 2 years, I've seen that there's a movement emerging. But what I've been worried about is that there is more of a movement in those that are creating those stories, but less of a movement in cultivating new audiences for those stories. And less of a, what's it called, of a plan in finding the audience that exists. Because there are audiences that exist.
Yep.
So, for example, look at what ArtX is,
mm-hmm.
you know, to the art industry and those that follow it. And look at the, for example, theater scene in Nigeria.
Yep.
Mm-hmm.
There is a following across the board. So, even like look at alternative music in mm-hmm. Nigeria and people that work in that realm.
Yeah.
There are fans of it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and I think that those guys have found a way, either through festivals or through various exhibitions and all that, to cultivate a following.
Yes. And grow their market.
That is missing, you know, in a lot of this conversation.
So, but then the question, and that's a valid point. And so the question is this, right? So we look at our local for what better word, art house cinema, let's just call it that.
Yes.
Like mm-hmm. movement, right? Where their only path right now is international.
Yes.
They have to get into the global festivals yep. and chart that journey. I mean, look at Lizard that got nominated for a BAFTA recently.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, so it's on the shortlist. Yeah. Right? Yes. It went to Sundance. It's a short film. It's set in Nigeria.
That's your sister, right?
No. My sister was on the long list. Unfortunately, she didn't make the shortlist.
Okay.
But
yeah. Shala Chibondu.
Yes. But that film was funded from the UK.
Yeah,
you know what I'm saying? There was, and so because there is no, and it was, I think it was, I don't know if it was grant or whatever, but there was a funding for those kind of voices that existed, that the commerciality was not necessarily the driver, but that the local film of that nature should exist.
Yeah.
So that patron culture, right?
Yeah.
So the question is that movement, because even in the film market in the US, that patron culture exists.
Yes.
So how is there a path to creating that patron culture for Nigerian film?
I believe so. Strongly.
And how does that path emerge?
So
as a distributor.
I believe that part, you know, is there. And it's something that we're working on.
Awesome.
That in due course, we would unveil. But just to say, we're already speaking to the people that we think would understand where we're coming from,
mm-hmm.
you know, in terms of this art house movement. So for us, I think that it's to identify the kind of partners mm-hmm. that know how to get these patrons. One of the things that we're also seeing emerging are the kind of people that are now exposed to our films, mm-hmm. you know, at a certain level,
mm-hmm.
And their appreciation for the quality. You know, a lot of times the issue has been, this is not a quality I want to be associated with.
Yep.
This is a level of mediocrity that valid. I'm not too sure mm-hmm. of. Mm-hmm. You know, nowadays, we're now seeing more of like, this looks good.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, this is the kind of story I want to tell. Can they tell this story?
Mm-hmm.
You know, and I feel mm-hmm. like we now have a job to say, whilst we've done all of this in the commercial realm, mm-hmm. this is what the possibilities are, you know, in mm-hmm. telling a lot more advocacy type thing, agenda type things,
mm-hmm.
you know. But like for us, as a business, I think is identifying the partners. And I want to say here that we are working assiduously. Something I've been big about, a lady called, I've forgotten her name now, Melissa, at the DMO, she sent me a pitch, you know. Mm-hmm. And it was an interesting business plan on art house movement.
Oh, nice.
You know, very, very interesting plan with very decent budget levels. And I was like, very, very good thinking. By the way, I think the Patreon network exists.
Okay.
For
okay.
sure.
For film or for art? It exists for art, definitely.
For art. For film, with the right conversation, yes.
Okay, so we can... Because technically, that was what half of Yellowstone was.
Yes.
Technically, they raised...
$2 million.
$8 million. For the existence...
From Nigeria.
Yes.
I thought it was just a fraction of that.
$8 million in front of it.
Yes. Dollars, yes. 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 With the Patreon network.
In 2012, 2013. So multiply by 150.
Jeez.
Yeah. So have you seen, and that was one film, right? Yeah. And it was an important film because Chimamanda's book was groundbreaking, etc., etc. I think, and so Nigerians taking ownership of that story was seen as important, and a lot of those patrons got behind that.
So I don't know whether it's appropriate to mention, but it's in the public, place. Wale Tinubu executive produced, Oloture. He's an art lover.
Yep. Yes, that's true. So yes,
you understand? Imagine so, and that film we're told has done very well on Netflix. So look at him and his networks, and the right people having the conversation, right people with the kind of track record, Inkblot, Film One, Ebony Life. You can mention them like as demonstrated on the commercial side. We know what to do. But the commercial side has also exposed us.
That's the thing, and that's the need for the commercial side.
Yes, the commercial side has exposed us to a level of critical acclaim,
yes.
A level of the kind of conscious, intelligentsia type world that we can take what your what your kind of leanings are from an art perspective, and we can execute.
Yes,
So I think that it's important for us to have built this profile. And what I used to tell people that were thinking about this 5-6 years ago, like, come on, guys. Let's make a business case first.
Yes.
Do you understand? You have to. Mm-hmm. And then let's now say we can venture out. And I think that what is happening, it's just great that it's happening. I think it's happening organically, because when it happens organically, it's also sustainable and it lasts.
Yes.
Yeah. So I have a question.
Awesome.
Yeah. I have one question. Now that we're talking about distribution and all of that,
yeah.
For a 5-year-old like me that knows nothing about the industry, what is distribution? What does the distributor do?
Wow.
So someone like
us, people don't do anything.
Yeah,
you
know,
like, okay. So
Just collecting 12%. Some people don't even know what you guys collect. So some people believe that all that money, when they say that wedding party did X amount of money, Filmone collected all the money. So let's break it down. What does
distribution
entail? What does Filmone, Film House, what do they do? So let's break it down.
Okay, great.
But that's true. People are also confusing.
You too.
Film One House.
So we got Film One House.
I mean,
thank you for that, Damola. I'll try my best to summarize. And if there's need for more detail, of course, I'll put it.
Mm-hmm.
So we like think of ourselves as a media entertainment group, and broken down into each individual company. Film House Cinemas is a cinema exhibition company where we design, we develop, we build, we operate, we manage, cinema locations.
Okay.
And that's from a business standpoint, from an audience or guest standpoint. It's a place where you go to experience film in a darkened auditorium, big screen, big picture.
Lovely popcorn.
Lovely popcorn.
Awesome popcorn. Great ambience. Popcorn, you understand?
True.
Where it's out of home experience,
okay,
where it cannot be rivaled, it cannot be duplicated. It's
I don't have the size of your screen at home.
So yeah, you don't have that size of screen.
But it's clearly working on
that's it. What we that you're working on. It. That's what we do. So and we always the idea is to continue to optimize that experience by adding the best state of art technology to a lot of the things that we do. So that's on the cinema side to put it, and I hope in layman terms it makes sense.
Yeah,
So we're always trying to. Like I said, the experience of watching, but also the experience of going to the cinema. So how do you purchase your tickets? How do you know about the films? All those kind of things. We want to ensure that we're always up to date.
Mm-hmm.
And we also want to ensure that if you're here watching in Nigeria and you go abroad, that it's very comparable.
Yes.
So we're always trying to go. And the greatest thing for us is that it's affordable. That's what we do on the cinema side. On Film One side, I like to refer to Film One as the content side of our business.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
And on the content side, we do everything from distribution, which you just asked of.
Yeah.
We now, produce. Of course, we produce.
Yes.
And I like to even separate co-producing from co-financing.
Yes.
Financing. Do you understand? So for a long period, we used to co-finance.
Yeah.
Where we were very much you know, and we've done that greatly with yourselves, where, you know, established creators,
mm-hmm.
you know, have a
you still collected IPO.
I didn't even say that.
He didn't say, oh, please, just give us our money back.
You should ask him if he were you.
So
IP just means intellectual property, so which means that you guys keep it.
We guys keep a portion. And that's what
We're still talking to the 5-year-old.
And that's why I said, you know, you have to give this so-called cabal some credit, if there's anything like cabal.
Mm.
Like, who does, you know, look at that level of collaboration where we understand that there is a risk being taken in terms of financing, and we're bringing creativity and our finance, but we'll share the IP. That's amazing. And thank you, Inbal, for what you're doing. That. So we co-finance, you know, in Film One. We also do aggregation. So co-financing and co-production are on the production side of things, the origination of the content.
Content.
In terms of aggregation, we provide services of, so we might not have the rights to your content directly, but we have a relationship with you, an understanding with you.
Yeah.
And we're able to, through that understanding, represent your title to like a global streamer, for example, or a bulk buyer of content. So that's what aggregation means. We're able to take content that we write, that we have, we manage rights for, and those that we have the relationships with, to say, you know, on a deal by deal basis, you know, here is the offer from a buyer.
So, for example, you are responsible for getting a lot of people's movies on Netflix.
Correct.
Well, because you see it on the logo when they do the poster.
They have started
insisting on it.
Yes, we have.
I can imagine that there's a brand fairy going around. Where is my logo?
So basically, you help.
And the logo is always bigger than the producer's logo.
And in color, even when the poster is black and white.
Just the yellow film one.
Blame it on brand guidelines that Inbal taught us. As we're going on. So, you know, we do that on the aggregation side. But let me return to distribution.
Yeah.
Distribution, we kind of divide into two parts.
Yeah.
The theatrical, which is the cinema distribution.
Yes.
And the non-theatrical or the ancillary.
Yes.
Now, let's break it down more into, you know, what does a distributor do, or what is distribution?
Mm-hmm.
Think of a distributor basically is in the business of, you know, launching and sustaining a film in the marketplace.
Yeah.
If you read a number of things, that's what they will always call it.
And he accuses me of being technical. See what he is, launching and sustaining a film.
And he's talking to a 5-year-old.
Is it a boat?
but I will break it down.
He started it now. What is it?
On the theatrical side. So, Damola, for example, you want to travel.
Yeah.
Right, you can buy it directly from the airline.
Yes.
Or you can buy an agent.
Yes.
I was going to call it brand, but
most times now, like a lot, you will see, I mean, the online travel agents do a lot more businesses than some of the airlines. Because of the offers that they have and all that.
Yeah.
The distributor has built years of experience, years of relationships.
Yes.
Like, and years of, you know, positioning. To be able to take off the load of, you know, putting your film in the market for you to go and create. That's what that distributor is there for you. Like, you've already done a hard job.
So the producer faced the work of creating the content, hand over to us. We will ensure that it gets to all
we
the
We will
cinemas.
Package.
Yes.
You understand? Think about the for example, the Mercedes-Benz dealer.
Yes.
It's no different. Mercedes-Benz has manufactured.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
But you know what? Give it to us. We will do the of showcasing, you know, of doing all the local partnerships, mm-hmm. of finding all the corporate accounts and all that. That's what our job is.
Mm-hmm.
So all the, like, how do I get my prints or my digital prints to the cinemas?
That's copies of the film.
Yeah, the copies of the film. Sorry, the copies of the film to the cinemas.
This is a very advanced 5-year-old. This 5-year-old is learning.
I'm now
10 years old now.
How do I speak to the regulator and get the classification, right? How do I date? How do I book? How do I schedule? Very different. They sound like interchangeable, but they're different
things. So date is the day the movie comes out.
Dating is out there. And strategy is like, who are you coming out against? Okay. What Premier League match is playing? Is it raining?
Is there Big Brother going on?
Is there all those issues?
Is it Hollywood movie coming out the same day?
Yes.
Okay.
That's dating.
Yeah.
Booking.
Yes.
Is the cinema going to take it? What am I going to do about the cinema taking it?
Okay.
In all cinemas, in select cinemas.
How can I get the cinemas to be interested in
it? How can I get them interested in taking it?
Okay.
Scheduling. What times do I get?
Okay, so now this is, now do I get
how many slots per day,
per day and all that.
Do I get 8 p.m. slots, 6 p.m. slots?
So can you feel like there's a little bit of it might sound transferable and general, but there's a lot of technicality to what we do. You know?
I want to ask one more question.
But that's one side, though. That's on really a round of like film or more administrative. There's the financial. So the reporting of the box office numbers,
okay,
the tax elements.
And that was the part I was going to.
Yes.
So, you know, because the people always say that, you know, these numbers, people are just doing Jomo yeah. and lying that somebody did 100 million. But we didn't see people in the cinema. The hall was empty.
Yeah.
But you went at 1 a.m.
There's a lot of conspiracy. There's a lot of conspiracy that goes on. And that's why I'm so glad that we made, you know, the announcement with ComScore.
ComScore, yeah.
You know, look, why would you put a figure that doesn't exist?
They still don't believe
because that figure is at the end what we're going to report.
So, exactly. You know, my favorite answer, sorry to cut you off, was Kemi's answer. No, Kemi's answer.
Okay.
If it's fake, that's the money paid me.
That's
the
money they paid.
Because we have to pay against that number.
So, my favorite answer is, why would I exaggerate it when the tax officers are going to come for that number?
Yeah, so you pay against the number
I should actually report under report if I'm trying to
given what happened to the people in China, let's not put ideas in people's heads.
Before they say that we're under reporting on some movies and over reporting on some others.
No. It doesn't happen. The point is that those figures are valid. Those figures are true.
Thank you, Zulu. That means a lot. And look, whoever is listening and watching, please, those figures are what they are. So, they are genuine. They're authentic.
Mm-hmm.
You know.
So shall I tell you the one thing that we need to solve for locally that we haven't solved for, which is a valid criticism of the industry as a whole.
Yeah.
Which I think we now that the ancillary market is stronger, we should solve for.
Yes.
Marketing. The producer, we should move it to a system where the producer is not responsible for marketing. That the distributor needs to be able to offer up a marketing package. It's at your discretion to accept it as a producer. But putting the primary responsibility, just like you said, that like, you are taking away all the other things from the producer.
Please take marketing.
Figuring out a way for marketing funding. I work in finance, right? I can solve my marketing. But part of the whole exclusion is driven by that. And it's one of those things that that historically we didn't want to take that risk. But I think that given the evolution, if you guys think about that, that is something that I think that you can figure out a package for.
Huh? Silence.
Think about
it. I agree. Okay. I know why I agree. I agree because the industry is evolving.
Yeah.
Where we were 5-6 years ago, the risk profile was high.
Okay.
The risk profile still exists. But the truth is that there are certain brands, film brands, that have established a level of consistency, a level of professionalism, a level of methodology to their work, their craft, that you can bet on.
Mm.
Okay.
You know, do you understand? Their antecedents show that, you know what, more than likely, if I put this amount in marketing, I'm more than likely going to get it back.
Yes.
Before, when you were releasing 24 films a year, as opposed to 100 films a year, and you didn't have enough screens, and like Nas mentioned, we're 5% in terms of box office. It was too much of a risk to take.
Yes.
Apart from that, also there were not enough platforms to cross collateralize. You know, my marketing investments on.
True. So cross collateralize
yes.
means that if basically the cinema returns are not enough, there are other places other you can license to,
yes, to get
the money back.
Thank you.
I have now become. I'm now 12 years old. I'm now 12 years old.
No, cross collateral. You're 16.
I'm 16. I've done my
act. I hope you passed.
Yeah.
I've been sitting for my second sitting.
Don't do that.
So I have a question to ask.
Yeah.
So now with the popularities.
Mm-hmm. It's okay. He's so back now 15.
See, I feel giggly, so I'm doing that one again. So with the popularity of the streaming platforms, do you believe that that's like competition for like the cinemas? Partly because, and look at what Warner's has now done, basically collapsing the window. So if a movie comes out in cinema on the same day it's coming out on a streaming platform, do you see that affecting us here in Nigeria?
I think that Nigeria is in a very peculiar place at the moment. I think it can become a challenge. I just feel like at the moment, and for me, for the next 2-3 years, we should be fine.
Okay.
But I think this is why I'm so, you know, bullish about this position. As a people, look at us. We're conversational. We're a community. We like to go out. We like to have fun. If you represent me in a way that I'm entertained, it's not an individual thing. A lot of people want to replicate that. A lot of people want to experience that. I think that's what lends itself well to our cinema.
Okay.
What has been missing is a consistent flow of those quality kind of depictions.
Oh, okay.
You know, once we have those things, like, and like Naz mentioned, that are well marketed, our people come out. People that are willing to celebrate buying a car.
Yeah.
Willing to celebrate, you know, funerals, willing to celebrate, you know, buying a piece of land, willing to celebrate opening a house.
Party people.
Of course, we do understand. So if you can give them in great locations, with that, look, you are paying this top dollar because you're going to, the experience is more than just seeing a film. I feel like for Nigerians, we're going to continue to see an upward trend. Okay. That's why likes of Kwam's Money, Omogeto,
you mentioned Kwam's Money first.
Faith of Alakada, you know, I've demonstrated that in a pandemic.
Yeah.
And you know that, Snake too.
And Rattlesnake too, yes, in a pandemic.
Not.
You know, in a the British happened to an extent. Wonder Woman,
yeah,
lately coming to America, have demonstrated that look, coming to America is even a very big success story because the level of piracy is on another level.
Yes.
Yeah, because it came out same day on Amazon. Day.
And did you see that it charted in Nigeria, the first one charted in Nigeria on Netflix?
I noticed that.
Yes.
I mean, people felt the need to watch. I felt the need to go back and watch. To go back and watch.
No, because after you watch part two, you actually do need to watch
part one. After watching part two, then I got annoyed a little bit and I went back to part one. So my body now came
look down. Look at this. You asked a quick question about the streaming versus, you know, cinema. Look, I think that Netflix has helped popularize Nigerian films such that people are more willing to watch Nigerian films in the cinema.
I agree. Yeah, true. I agree with that.
And you know, and it's going to get better. I think like you will see.
Yes, because more... a lot of people became disillusioned after a while. You know, Nigerian, they felt disappointed by the content that we kept putting out.
Yes, yes.
So once they started to watch Netflix and they started to see the kinds of things that we had started to do, they're like, oh, I can actually watch this in the cinema. Yes. And so it helped us.
But you see, and that's the danger that we face, that if we don't solve that content curation, content programming part of things well as cinema, that's where we're going to start then, not just struggling, but that could be like our demise. So we have a challenge, you know, and that question is so great. We have a challenge to ensure the right content comes into cinema. We build that audience.
So can I push back on that a little bit? Yes. So one of my beliefs is that, which is one of the things that I wrote about, genre, I don't think genre matters.
Okay.
So I believe that if you look at the Nigerian film industry, there's an example of pretty much every genre that has been successful.
True.
So I always push back when people say there's a type
maybe
of movie.
Maybe except sci-fi a little bit.
Well, sci-fi, well, I mean, we do, when we get Neo on the podcast, we'll talk about but technically, right, Maif and I technically is sci-fi.
Yes.
Juju is Nigerian sci-fi now, technically.
Well, like,
somebody said, that science, that magic is only science
like Nigerians do agree and like the fantastical. The question is, what is the packaging? So my general view is that all genres are open and valid and welcome.
Yeah.
The question is, you have to do more work for certain genres, just like we're talking about art house earlier.
Yeah.
But I still think that there's a big enough market across board for everything.
Yeah.
But having put you on the spot, like now, and pushed back.
Now that we're talking about film and creation,
what
create your ideal movie?
Wow.
So let's start.
But wait, don't, before we start the movie. So now, so before you would have said, oh, I'm doing a movie to make 500 million.
Mm.
But Mogeto has showed you that 500 million is too low an ambition. Yeah, yeah, so we are going for Black Panther.
Okay.
So what
800.
Do you, so basically, this, of course, nobody will hold you to this in a court of law. Of course.
I will hold you. Yeah. So, I'll remind you of this.
I'm taking notes because that's my next movie. So
let's play a game. So what do you think would be an ideal movie?
Your ideal movie that you know that will be like a blockbuster, that will break all the records, will rival Black Panther, Omogeto, Wedding Party, blah, blah, blah. Yeah. So let's start. First things first, genre.
Yeah.
I'm going to copy it and just go straight to the point. We do Wedding Party 3.
Wedding Party 3. No problem. Wedding Party 3. So now, what's going to be the plot this time around?
You can dip in. No, think of our inbox. How many Wedding Party 3 pitches do you currently have in our inbox?
Now they'll be sending it to him now so that he can be able to send it to us.
I'll let you know that we don't currently have any because I've deleted it all.
Fantastic. Well done.
No, but they'll send it to him now. I'm trying to push it in his way.
We are not doing Wedding Party 3 pitches.
Wedding Party 3 pitches, those are... I mean, the highest number of pitches we've ever received.
Oh, wow.
Yes, I have a story. I have an idea.
I need to work for wedding party.
But would it be right to pull it out? Like, would it be right to put that if I had the idea? We'll talk into
that. No, that's what I want you to say it so that now people so, now know what you want so that they can be sending pitches your way and not our way.
No, thank you. But like I said, I think that if there was an iconic IP that can really, that of course has already proven itself time and time again, and that I think the time is right. To think about it, you know, deliberately.
Okay, yes. So you know where I am, right? Yes, I so believe in never go back. Like, so always go forward. That's where I am. So I have to say that.
I'm with you. I'm with you, my brother.
I'm there to just make money. But I have a question to ask. So if it's not wedding party,
If it's not wedding party, you know, I've been thinking of a franchise like Taken. I've been thinking about it like for the last year.
Taken.
So, Man on a Mission.
Or Woman on a Mission.
In an Ajegunle setup, like, you know, like going to go and rescue his daughter, you know, and the fight scenes and sequences and choreography is really, really authentic.
Yeah, but you know, our fight scene is different.
No, but to be fair, there's a bit of something to that, too, because technically, the end, the last, spoiler alert, it's made 600 and something million, so everybody has seen it. The last act of Omogeto was that.
Yes.
Literally. It was a
But
people love that third act, massive. So there is a market for the action.
Guys, I actually think
I'm not really on
this. So I hear you, but I think that it can be written so smartly that the fight scenes don't have to be, you know, the focal point. It doesn't have to be that many. It should be the chase.
But have you seen Nigerians fight?
So like all the Merry Men type.
Probably not that. The intrigues of like you call and you just narrowly miss somewhere.
So
and
like
chases.
More spy.
So suspense.
Okay. More suspense. But
who's going to be your lead? This one that you're saying action
no,
movie.
No, you will get death threats.
Why you like this?
But I don't mind saying two or three.
Please tell us. Don't mind.
How many of them have six pack?
Of course, in that mode, R&B will come in that mode.
Really?
Yeah, in that mode. If I'm thinking Taken.
Okay, Taken.
I just feel like that older folk. But there's a guy that a lot of people have forgotten and we've been talking lately and I can't wait for his comeback. Sentobi.
Sentobi.
Is he coming back?
He's coming back.
Well, he can.
He can.
Okay. Lovely.
The original action hero.
But wait.
Why would you ever consider someone like Kanayo? He can be fighting and then jazz at the same time.
I think Ramsey would be even more athletic and mobile. You know, and
They're two different things. Ramsey is giving us nice gun. This guy,
will give you jazz. Juju jazz, you know,
I also like Bob Mano.
Okay.
But you know, I'm also thinking commercially.
Commercially.
Yeah. Well, of course, Sentobi would be for a certain crowd, but I think Sentobi would be able to pull off a lot of stunts. Mm. So where he might be lacking in terms of like, the people that know him.
Yeah.
Just by pulling off some stunts and, you know, he has
the physicality.
Physicality. I think it's enough as a selling point.
All right, cool. So now, love interest.
Whew.
If there's love interest or the daughter that he has to rescue.
Please. This love interest needs to be old. Let's not be pairing this.
No, what I'm saying is this. If you either you do love interest.
And love interest.
It's Sentobi and like Adesua would be interesting. not as relationship, like daughter.
Okay.
You guys, I might feel this creative thing.
Give me the theme, let me push it.
I like the problems, don't let me feel this thing. I don't know who else, maybe.
So speaking of Adesua, so this is something that I remember when we were designing the initial wedding party shortlist, he put her on it.
History
was made.
Thank you very much.
Not just history, a lifetime.
Bam.
Was made. Yeah. Now there's even a continuation of generations.
Yeah.
Congratulations, guys.
Yes.
On that.
Yes.
Right. So yeah, that'll be a lovely time. I'm struggling to RMD.
But I didn't forget that because of that one decision.
You know what? I think
he has been bullying us on casting.
I found out. You know, I put at this
one.
Same way, it's your idea.
Yes. Wedding party was my idea, not the wedding party.
I think RMD and Regina Askia will be interesting.
Mad. Regina Askia.
It's like some nostalgia. Some nostalgia play.
When nobody's thinking, RMD.
So who's going to be your director?
Whew.
he will get death threat, but I want to hear this.
No, this, let's ask the question.
No comment.
Let's ask the question. Come on.
Okay, I'll say two or three people.
Two or three. One. Okay, so two or three.
The fourth or fifth, they will come for you.
Okay. In no particular order.
Yeah, in no particular
order. In alphabetical order, like no the wedding party.
In no particular order. Kemi Adetiba.
Kemi Adetiba. She has done with alphabetical, though, so that you know, some people won't vex.
So
that, you
A is the Adetiba he took.
It's the Adetiba he took, so A. It's also Adekemi, so A.
Ni Akimolaya.
Akimolaya, ni is on his
own. And that's cheating now.
And just for the consistency and the sheer ability to do back-to-back, Funke.
Oh, Funke.
Hey.
Okay.
Yeah.
I mean, she can do comedy, she can do action, she can do drama.
That's two women to one guy.
I think that those would be... Sorry. I think in terms of the... They need to be meticulous in terms of the attention to detail, in terms of execution, but particularly storytelling. I think both of the
women, yeah.
Okay. So I think that...
He is a woman in
so
this
basically,
case.
We'll tell him to basically how much he really make, but what is the answer? If I wrote the script, what would you say?
Put together the whatever. You know, first of all, what would it cost to make? First of all, what do you think it cost to make?
I think that kind of film, 80 to 100 million.
80 to 100 million.
Yeah.
How much would it now make in box office?
I think that kind of film, if it's done very authentically, would do well in West Africa, would get South African distribution and theatrical, and pockets in the UK and US.
Or you want to go on that wedding party, Waka?
Yes. And I think that they are ready now.
Okay.
I think post-pandemic, I think that Mogeto has also shown us in Dubai, for example.
Yeah.
Mogeto has done very well there.
Nice.
You know, in the lockdown. So I think that there will be pockets. So I feel like there can be a gross revenues of 400 to 500 million.
Okay.
So across those territories.
I just realized something. So you know how we had Wedding Party 1 having the Nigerian record?
Yes.
And Wedding Party 2 having the international record?
Yes.
We have handed both crowns
to Mogeto.
Yes.
Yeah. We are still there.
So wait. Last question. What will be the title of this movie?
That's on
Bass Boss.
Bass Boss is part of the origin story.
So if anyone decides to write Bass Boss with all of these people and you can pull it off, pull up, get 100 million.
Hello, remember we just said in our earlier podcast, no unsolicited.
No, I'm saying that they should send it
to film. Yes, send it to film one.
However, why don't we say this? This is an idea. This is how ideas are birthed, right? Mm. And this is how you sit down and you have this conversation.
Mm.
So why don't we collaborate as collaborators that we are? Let's do this thing together.
Is this like your cruise ship movie?
Let's not talk about the cruise ship. It will still happen.
I think that we should think about it very strongly. I think that there's an action film there in the making. There is, you know, the legend of the arm robbers that we know, either it was Anini or...
Anini.
Yeah. Charles announced Rambo, right?
Yeah, friends are playing there with Charles Opalike. They're doing something like that. But it's not something that we're unused to. We've heard some of these things. So I feel like we can build a fictional character, you know, a fictional world where this thing happens and it's believable. I think what's always been missing is the believability.
Yes, we have to figure out how to tell a Nigerian version of action.
And
we did it basically in the early Nollywood at those production values, etc. So it's how to translate it in a manner that can compete favorably with other offerings on cinema. Because once you change the medium, it changes the expectation.
Expectation, totally.
All right.
So Moses, are you going to buy us popcorn now as you go and watch a movie?
Yeah, I mean, but definitely.
I mean, we are now in moving from your house to your house.
Definitely. Popcorn, if I so sure you don't want to add, you know, hot dogs
and shawarma.
And shawarma too.
Just salted popcorn.
All right, so thank you very much, Moses, for coming. These things always run long. I mean, but...
I understand what you're talking about. It's not as if there's an ad break coming up.
But thank you very much. You're always an awesome guest. And yeah, Meet and Greet is a... What this is? Is a podcast? A video podcast. I never know what to say at this point.
It's a vlog.
It's a vlog. And basically, you can find it everywhere. You listen to podcasts, on YouTube, snippets on Instagram.
Check in the show notes. You'll find it in all the various places.
Even though, do we do snippets on non-celebrities like Moses?
Ah, Moses.
You don't want your next movie to come out. You need to follow him.
Yes, please.
Moses Babatope on Instagram.
Thank you. Correct.
Are you on Twitter?
I'm not on Twitter.
Okay, because it's only on Instagram.
I can keep saying. Instagram is fine. I'm on Facebook as well.
Okay.
And on Facebook.
And Moses Babatope.
Moses Olubabatope.
Olubabatope.
Olumuiwa.
Oh, okay. Yes. So for all the knowledge on distribution and everything you need to know,
I charge you.
And send him DMs. You want to do Basbos?
Basbos. Let's say Basbos. I'm coming for you. Coming soon to a cinema near you.
Thank you very much, guys. See you next time.